The Chenchus are a Telugu-speaking food-gathering tribe living in the Nallamalai forests of Andhra Pradesh in India, spread over the districts of Mahabubnagar, Karnool, Prakasam and Guntur. They are a conservative tribal group and have not made many changes in their lifestyle or tried to adapt to modernity. They live in the enclosed space and geography, leading a life of unbroken continuity. The Nallamalai forests are deciduous and deep. They cover mountainside and are full of treacherous pathways and dangerous ridges. The Chenchus are undaunted by their natural surroundings and set out to gather food or hunt animals. The bow and arrow and a small knife is all the Chenchus possess to hunt and live. They hunt wild animals like boar and deer. But with the increasing interest in wildlife conservation, they are content to hunt small animals like lizards, rabbits, and wild birds. Their meal is fairly simple and usually consists of gruel made from jowar or maize and boiled or cooked jungle tubers. They mix tamarind fruit with tamarind ash and eat. This is especially good for pregnant women. They normally eat before setting out to gather food in the morning and eat again when they return home in the evening. This speaks of the enormous stamina of the Chenchus, who trek on foot through jungle paths all day long. The slender build of their bodies is deceptive and express little of their strong and resilient nature. The Chenchus collect jungle products like roots, fruits, tubers, beedi leaf, mahua flower, honey, gum, tamarind, and green leaves, and make a meager income of it by selling these to traders and government cooperatives. The Chenchus do not care much for money or material wealth. They have hardly developed any technique of preserving food. Their care for the future is marginal, as they are used to living on a day-to-day basis. As a result, they have not cultivated much interest in agriculture. Though at times they work as forest laborers, they mostly prefer to fall back on their native skills to hunt and gather food. But the inroads of modern development have found their ways to the Chenchu homeland. Today, the forest region no longer belongs to the Chenchus. It has been declared as a tiger reserve sanctuary. The government has been motivating the Chenchus to adapt to agriculture, but has failed. The Chenchus refuse to be displaced from the forest and continue to live in harmony with the tigers in the sanctuary. Centuries of life in the forest have deprived the Chenchus of an ability to adapt easily to external situations. Though some of their children are sent to government schools, there are very few instances of educated Chenchus finding their way into mainstream modern society. The Chenchus are struggling to adapt to new patterns of life as the forest resources dwindle with time. The Chenchus have been their own masters for many generations and have not needed the services of any outsider. They are unmindful of an external society which is alien and unimportant to them. The life in the wild is one of hardship, but the Chenchus live on, cheerfully unmindful of their difficulties. The boundaries of their native perception are defined by the natural boundaries of their geography. The roots are strong, and the bonding to an age-old tradition is deep and abiding. The Chenchus continue to live contently in their ancestral homeland as true sons and daughters of the forest to celebrate the joys and gains of life. A Chenchu village is known as Penta. Each Penta consists of a few huts that are spaced apart and are grouped together based on kinship pattern. The close relatives live nearby and the distant ones further away. Their homes comprise of few belongings and are generally sparse and Spartan in appearance. Pedda Manishi, or the village elder, is generally the authority to maintain social harmony in a family or a village. Generally, his counsel and word are final in all matters of the village.
Boom Dundale, Yedulkawale, जावे इतने बापाड़ा लेंगे यार दिन के ना बापाड़ा रिंगा वो साधु लंडे साधु साधु ने लूंडा रू साधु साधु चुंडा रू कौन था मैंने नौकर लूंडा ही उन्हें यार नौकर लेने लो बाहन बात चुंडा रू ना नौकर ला मेरा यानी ये लोटा का जन्म आता माता मो यार ये भूमि चाहिए का या ये भूमि लेका ये दुल्लेका ये पेट पिलल को जान थिल को इतना रु आपड़ वाला मैं हम पैदा मब मेरे बिना मापड़ो आपड़ इनका इनका थिल ले दू आपड़ो आ थिल लेका ये मन देना गवर्नमेंट रेंज है तो दो ये बैन लिस्टुंडी ये दिलिस्टुंडी ये बांड लिस्टुंडी ये मन देना तीस का पैसा वो ले देंगे చచ్చిపోతామో ఏమో సావదించదా ఏమి అన్నది దయ్యము పెద్ద గిన్నది సారు అట్లా విండి బాగుపడలేదు చెంచు జనము ఇప్పుడు అంతా ఈ డీజల్ ఎదిగినారు ఇప్పుడు డీజల్ తెలుగు పెట్టారు ఇప్పుడు పట్టణాలు అన్నీ తిరుగుతున్నారు ఇప్పుడు అంతా తెలుగు పెట్టారు ఇప్పుడు కావాల్సింది భూమి వీళ్ళ ఇల్లు
The Chenchus are a broad, exogamous group that is subdivided into various clans. They follow the ancient system in Hindu tradition of gotras, which represent the lineage and descent of clan members. There are 26 gotras found among the Chenchus, and the various clans are identified by their gotra name. They never marry within the gotra or clan and intermarry other clan members. The wife bears the husband's gotra after marriage. The marriage is known as pelli and takes place through a negotiated arrangement involving elders or through the choice of the young couple concerned. The ceremony is performed with traditional rituals in front of the community and the village elders. The elders belonging to the Uttaluri clan must be present as a matter of traditional custom as the priest or Kularaju officiates over the marriage rites. The maternal uncle of the bride gives the bride away and there is a feast and celebration at the end of the ceremony. The newly married Chenchu couple set up their own house and are expected to live together ever after. Divorce is allowed among the Chenchus on the grounds of incompatibility. Widow remarriages are common among them.
ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ ఏ
Lord Mallikarjuna, an incarnation of Lord Shiva, fell in love with a young Chenchu maiden by name Chenchu Lakshmi and married her. The Chenchus believe that they are the descendants of this couple and have a special place and mention in the Puranas, temple records and chronicles. For ages, the Chenchus have been associated with the famous Sri Salem temple in Andhra Pradesh, situated at the heart of Chenchu land. The Sri Salem temple, dedicated to Lord Shiva and Devi Brahmaramba, is a sacred pilgrim center for Hindus of all sects. The Chenchus have a strong belief system. They worship their deities with great devotion. Lord Ishwara among them is known as Lingamayya and Shakti as Maisamma or Peddamma. The worship of both male and female deities is accompanied by puja during the month of Shravan, that is from July to August. The ritual of Lord Lingamayya represents the ancient mode of worshipping Lord Shiva. Chenchus love their gods dearly and pray to them in earnest and endearing terms. The devotion borders on frenzy and passion and is magical in effect on the surroundings. The celebrations can be austere, serene and simple, and sometimes they can be wild, intoxicating and mystical.
Om namah shivaya. 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 Om namah shivaya.
The rich folklore of their forefathers inspires and guides them to maintain a solid tradition. The dance, the gaiety, and the lyricism of their life reflects the joy and innocence as they live a life of rich contentment, seeking and aspiring for very little.
Workshop. I hope first all of you got the handout, right? Great. So tell me, what did you watch for the past 20 minutes? Did you watch it or did you doze off? Yes? Yes? Who did you watch first? Chenchus. Okay. Where do these Chenchu people live? In the Nallamala forest. Very good. And what language do they speak?
Telugu.
Telugu? Or is it a language that is very close to Telugu? Yes? They speak Kannada? We'll discuss. And what is it about these people? What kind of life do they have? Where do they live? What is their geography like? Forests. What is their economy based on? Are they sitting before computers and running softwares? Yes. What is their economy based on? Hunting, right? Clear. Very good. But why are we interested in Chenchus? Why did we spend time watching them for the past 20 minutes or so? Yes? They are? Yes? As example for one of the tribes. Okay, good. But why are we studying tribes? Why are we interested in tribes? Chenchus are an example of a tribes, but why are you studying tribes in the first place? Because it's anthropology class, simple, right? Yes? Yes. So why does anthropology study tribal people? Complete evolution of man. To understand complete evolution of man, will it be incomplete without tribals? Yes? We are all in agreement. But it doesn't seem so natural to me. Why should you study tribals to understand evolution of man? Modernization starts with them. Okay. Anybody else? Yes? The rest of you? What do you think? I'll come to that. But first, we'll have a lecture of 1 hour and then I will take your questions. First, I will run you through what is anthropology. So, our workshop is organized into 3 parts. The first part is a video. Then I run you through some broad ideas and then I will take some questions and close it. Right? But what are we trying to address? What are we trying to address in today's session? We are going to broadly address these 5 questions. First, what is anthropology? Next, is it a good optional? Then, does it help with GS? Why anthropology here in Law Excellence? And what is the course structure? Because these are the most common questions that I get from students whenever we take a workshop. First, what is anthropology? What is anthropology? Why are we interested in this subject? Why are we interested in the subject of anthropology? Yes. Why are we interested in anthropology? What is anthropology in the first place? What do you think? Study of? Is it study of man? What is anthropology? Study of? What is sociology then? Study of? So how does study of man differ from study of society? So as you rightly said, anthropology is study of man. What is the study of man? So anthropology, the word anthro stands for man. Anthro refers to man, and pology or ology is any study. So anthropology is nothing but study of man. But how do we study man? Now you are clear with the meaning, right? Anthropology is nothing but study of man, and it has a sister discipline called sociology, which is study of society. Now how do we study man? How do we study man? There are anthropology studies this man in three broad directions. There are three broad dimensions through which anthropology tries to study man. What are these three broad dimensions? First, as you all rightly said, is evolution of man. Evolution of man. Under this, yes, we under evolution of man, what do we study? We try to understand that comes later. Growth, but more importantly, how did we evolve like this? How did human body evolve from apes into a bipedal structure? Do you know of any other animal or any other organ species which walks on 2 feet? Don't tell me pigeons and hens. Yes? Most humans are unique in the sense that they have a unique locomotion, that is bipedal. They stand on 2 feet erect. They have an erect posture and you can walk on 2 feet. So we analyze how did humans develop this unique physical structure. What was the forces? What are the various stages through which we evolved from an ape to a complex species, that is Homo sapiens? That story is part of evolution of man. Now, along with evolution of man, we will also study, after evolving, how do humans vary? Are all humans the same? No. You're not the same, right? People vary. Vary in what ways? Starting from very clear, yes? Height, weight, exactly. Very good. Your name? Pratyusha, yes. So height and weight is one clear thing that you can observe. Skin color, can you clearly see somebody is dark, somebody is fair? Some are colored. Yes? Some are colored. So these are some clear indicators. What else? Blood group? Do all of you have same blood group?
No.
Do all of you have same immune levels? So there are some differences that we can see. Do you see a person and say, I know his blood group?
No.
You must have superpowers to be able to do that. Then we don't need blood banks. We can just ask you to come and tell us which person has A positive for blood donation. But so there are some differences which we cannot tell by seeing. Those include, let's say, hemoglobin levels, blood groups, immunity levels, so on and so forth. We are discovering more and more variation. So there are differences across people. So we will study how do living humans differ from one another, and they may differ in many ways, but we are interested in some differences which have evolutionary significance. That is, some differences give some advantage to people. What do I mean by this? Take skin color. We think skin color is random. Some are white, some are dark skin. But is there any significance to this skin color? Have you ever given this a thought? Is skin color a random variation? Yes? Is skin color a random variation? Or is there some logic behind this? Where do you find geographically people with dark skin? Close to equator? Very good. Where do you find, yes? Close to equator, Tamil Nadu, Africa. Isn't it? Not in India, but across the world. Where do you find people with light skin color? Not the country wise, but geographically. Away from equator? In the, you don't find them in the tropical regions, right? You find them in the temperate regions. So, what can you conclude from that? Yes? Why should color vary based on geographical conditions? What is the sunlight? Isn't it so? Close to equator, there is direct sunlight. Sun rays come in a direct angle. So, if you have light skin color, what happens? You get skin burns. Dark skin color makes sure skin does not absorb UV radiation. That is why those who are close to equator tend to have dark skin. Dark skin is beneficial near equator. But as you go away from equator, what happens? Sunlight is less. Basically, sun rays come at an angle. Now, what happens when sun rays come at an angle? Your body doesn't get enough sun rays to synthesize vitamin D. Vitamin D comes from sun rays. So, if you have dark skin, what happens? Dark skin doesn't absorb sunlight. That is beneficial close to equator because there is a lot of sunlight. But if you are away from equator and you are already short of sunlight, and if you have dark skin which doesn't absorb sunlight, you are at a double disadvantage. When you have light skin, it absorbs maximum sunlight, and that's how you get to produce vitamin D. So this is how something like skin color, which we thought is totally random, has a evolutionary significance. So we will study many more variations like that and try to understand why people vary. That is why racism is a wrong idea. What is racism? The idea that some people, white, are superior. But clearly, anthropology tells us if whites come to hot areas, they will not be able to survive. Because white skin gives you skin burn. That is why those who have white skin tend to tan. What is tanning? Darkening. So even white skin people are becoming dark skin when they come to hot areas. So skin color has a certain evolutionary explanation. So here in this first dimension of anthropology, we will study evolution of man. We will study what is called as human variation. And this is called as physical anthropology. This discussion is called as physical anthropology. In your paper, first paper, you will see this from chapter 9.1 to 12. Physical anthropology is chapter 9.1 to 12 and 1.4 to 1.8. In your syllabus in paper 1. Second, after studying evolution of man, we also study something. We studied human body. But is humans just, what makes humans human, unique? Is it just their body? Do chimpanzees wear jeans and wear sunglasses? Do they put on watches? Do they have specs like you? So what is it that humans are having beyond this other primates or other apes? Yes? They also eat food, but they may not eat pizza, burgers or? Yes? Humans have culture. Is it not? We have culture. Our culture is in the way you eat, the way you dress, the way you speak, the kind of equipment you use. Did humans begin with making cell phones and laptops when they came onto the planet? No, right? How did human culture begin? What were the earliest things that humans made? Fire. Do chimpanzees make cell phones, cars? Do they build skyscrapers? Only we do, right? You're sure? Only humans are capable. But did we begin with building skyscrapers and making mobile phones or producing vaccines? What did we begin with? We are creating things, right? We are manipulating nature. Do chimpanzees and gorillas manipulate nature? After all, our DNAs are same 99%. The 1% makes a lot of difference here. So, what did we begin making? Stone tools. What were the first things that humans made? Stone tools, very simple crude tools. So, we will study the story of cultural evolution. How did human culture evolve? How did human culture evolve? We didn't begin with all this technology that came later, so many thousands of years later. But the earliest things that humans made as part of their culture is stone tools, and this discussion is part of archaeological anthropology, or simply archaeology. In archaeology, we study these issues. We study how human culture evolved from the level of stone age to today's complex culture. We will study Paleolithic age, next Mesolithic, then Neolithic, finally Chalcolithic ages. So how did human culture evolve over a span of thousands of years? That will be our focus in cultural evolution. After studying cultural evolution, when we said study of man is not just his body, right? Humans clearly are different in the sense that they have the ability for making cultures. So, next we study human culture. Human culture. And this is part of socio-cultural anthropology, or it is often called as social anthropology. And this is the major dimension or the major theme of today's anthropology, not these two. In our syllabus, this is about 25%. Cultural evolution is about another 15%. And the study of culture is for about 60% of our syllabus. 60% of our syllabus is largely the study of culture, and that is called as socio-cultural anthropology. And this includes paper 1 from 2.1 to about 7. 2.127 is sociocultural anthropology. Now let me give you some details of the social anthropology, because this is a very big topic. Social anthropology. Just take this handout and look at topics from 2.125. Just give me the headings that you see in each of those points, just the headings. First words.
Culture.
Next. Next.
Marriage.
Then?
Family.
Then?
Kinship.
Economic organization. Political organization.
Religion.
Theories. Then? Very good. So, now do you know what do we study under this? What do we study under this? You tell me now. What do we study under social anthropology? We study things like, first of all, what is culture? What is society? What is marriage? What is family? Kinship? The economic basis of a society? How does each society get its food? Each society must have a method through which they source their food, right? So, we study these mechanisms through economic organization systems. Next, in each society there are some political systems. We study that through political organization, and every society has a religious system, has a belief system. So, that is social anthropology. Social anthropology broadly consists of two topics: social institutions and under social institutions we study marriage, family, kinship, religion, etc. All this comes under social institutions. Then every discipline, every social science has a philosophical basis. What is the philosophy of this subject? What is the philosophical basis of this discipline? What are the ideas that form the basis for this subject? That is called as anthropological theories. Unit 6 in your syllabus. Just look at unit 6. Unit 6 in paper 1. You will see various anthropological theories. What are those theories? Can you read those first few names to me? Classical evolutionism, historical particularism, functionalism, structuralism. Very good. Then, neo evolution, cultural materialism. Very good. Now, wait. Next, do you see some names in brackets? From cultural materialism, give me the names in brackets as well. Harris, next. Yes? After cultural materialism? Turner and? Name of the approach. What is the name of the approach? Symbolism? Do you see some? After cultural materialism, do you see symbolic and interpretative theories? Read both. Read the first words and those in the brackets as well. Symbolic and? By Turner, Schneider and Geertz. Next, cognitive theories by Tyler and Conklin. Next, so what are we studying in the anthropological theories? We will see various approaches to study anthropology, and in each approach we will come across certain people who propounded or who proposed that approach. They are called as thinkers. We will study some thinkers. So all those names, Harris, just look at the first point, classical evolutionism. What names do you see? Tyler, Morgan, Fraser. Very good. So we will come across people we call as thinkers. So we will study some thinkers and we will study the approach their thinkers proposed. Classical evolutionism, neo evolutionism, etc. So, in anthropological theories, we study all these aspects together. In anthropological theories, we study all these aspects together. That is the focus of theories. So, socio-cultural anthropology is about social institutions and theories. All this is paper 1. Next, what do we do in paper 2? In optional, you have two papers, right? Paper 1 and paper 2, you are familiar with that? We have two papers for optional, paper 1, paper 2. Where do you find paper 2 in the syllabus? Page 3, last paragraph onwards. Page 3, last paragraph onwards, you will see paper 2, right? What do we study in paper 2? In paper 1, we study concepts. In paper 1, we study concepts. In paper 2, we study the applications and the examples of those concepts in India. Paper 2 is also called as Indian anthropology. Paper 2 is also called as Indian anthropology. So, in paper 1, we will nowhere focus only on India. Our focus will be the world. We will study anthropology as a subject. We will study anthropology as a subject, and we will study at a world level what are the concepts, what are the ideas in this discipline. Next, in paper 2, we will focus on India, the Indian context. So, in paper 2, we will study first certain aspects of Indian society like caste system, Indian villages, etc. And in paper 2, next we study tribal people. We study tribes, various tribes. Even in paper 1, we will come across many tribal examples. When we study marriages, we will study the marriage of Chenchus. Did you watch the marriage of Chenchus? Is it same as our marriage? No, different, right? Did you notice the religion of Chenchus? Do they have a religious belief system? Is it like us? Something somewhat similar but also different, right? So, like that, we will study the marriage practices, the religious practices of various societies through various examples. Chenchus is just the first example. As the course starts, we will watch more and more such videos of tribal people. I will show regularly a lot of videos on Chenchus, Gonds, Koyas. Where do Koyas live? Yes? Bhadrachalam. They are being displaced by a big dam that is being built there. What is the dam? Polavaram. Have you heard of Polavaram Dam? Yes. So, we will study various such tribal people, and through them, through their examples, we will understand the concepts. This is anthropology. So, clear now? We have two papers, and in these two papers, we broadly study man, but we study man in these three dimensions. First dimension is evolution. Second dimension is the evolution of culture. Third dimension is the study of culture. And the study of culture involves study of marriage, family, kinship, religion, political system, economic system, etc. All this is study of man, right? So, now are you clear about what is anthropology? What is anthropology? Study of man. And we study man in broadly three dimensions. What are those three? Evolution of man, cultural evolution, and the study of culture. What are the three branches of anthropology that correlate with these three? Physical anthropology, archaeological anthropology, socio-cultural anthropology. Very good. You are all very quick learners. My job is going to be easy then. Next. Fine. Now that you know what is anthropology, is it a good optional? First, let us discuss what makes something a good optional. Why are you all here? Yes? Yes? But why did you have to choose anthropology? Yes? Very good. So you're all here because you want to clear the exam. And choosing anthropology is with that goal in mind, right? You all have a end goal. You're not here to become anthropologists, are you? You're not here to get a PhD in anthropology, are you? No. You're all here because you want to get into the civil service. And choosing an optional is an important decision you will make in that process. And because you want to get a rank, you thought you want to choose a subject that will make it easy for you to get that rank. Simple. So, first here, to understand what is a good optional, you have to understand the importance of optional in the whole examination process. How many marks is the examination for? Yes? The examination is for 1750 marks. That is, you have 7 papers. You have 4 GS, 1 essay, 2 optional papers. GS 1, 2, 3, 4, essay, optional 1, optional 2. 7 papers and you have 250 each. Of this, optional is about 500. Now, though it is 500, in actual reality, optional plays a very important role in your success because this is not your board exam or college exam where everybody can get in 10th class, everybody gets 90%. Everybody can be a topper. But here, is it possible? This is a competitive exam. The topper gets only 50%. So it is not about how you perform, it's about relative merit. It's about how you perform compared to everybody else. So when you look at that, what you will realize when you look at scores of rankers is that most people, those who get ranks, those who don't get ranks, score very similar marks in their general studies. Because GS is an ocean. It's a very broad discipline and it is not really possible to have thorough preparation there. Because you may prepare some topics, they may ask something totally different. And all your preparation may not help you on that day. If they throw syllabus aside and choose to give a very random paper, all the effort you put does not give you results. So because of the hard nature of GS, because of the, not even hardness, it is just sheer unpredictability. Many people call UPSC as unpredictable PSC. So because of the sheer unpredictability to GS, it is very difficult to get very high scores in GS. In GS, it is very difficult to get high scores. So everybody, those who get selected, those who don't get selected, in each paper, you may just get, you are in a range of plus minus 10. That's it. But that is not the case with optional. Those who get ranks are getting ranks not because they do well in all papers. They are doing well only in some papers. Some papers are having a greater say in deciding who gets a rank. In other papers, everybody is same. Now, what are those papers? Optional is the first there. Essay, ethics. These papers are playing a very big role in deciding success. Of all the papers, optional is very important. Because in optional, a topper may get 340 on 500. Somebody else may get 240 or 250. Now, what is the difference? 90 or 80-90 marks. Is the game finished here itself? Even if the topper gets same marks as you in every other subject, just the performance in optional places him in the list. So those who prepare well are preparing well in optionals, because in optionals If you prepare well, you can perform well. In GS, even if you prepare well, there is no guarantee you will perform well. Because in addition to your preparation, many other stars must work in your favor that day. The paper must be designed in such a way that what you have prepared must be asked. And you must be able to present in a structured way in that huge amount of syllabus. But with optional, that's not the case. If you prepare well, you are able to deliver it. Is it not? Because the syllabus is defined, concepts are fixed. So, optional is very, very important in your examination success. So, please keep this in mind. So, now based on this, what can we say is a good optional? A good optional is one where first you should have the syllabus must be limited. The questions must be relatively easy. If your optional is also like GS, does it do you any good? It is a double problem, right? Your optional must be different than GS, slightly predictable. If you study, you should be able to deliver. And you should have good teaching, good notes, material, good test series to practice, and good peer group. And your optional must be doing well in UPSC, because there are so many optionals in UPSC. Sometimes some optionals are treated very badly. They don't give scores. Over the past few years, geography and PubEd went through that phase. They were not at all giving scores because in these papers. So students who took these optionals were getting low marks despite performing well. Because of multiplicity of optionals, they do something called as scaling. Maths cannot be compared with anthropology, right? It is a problem that is clear subject. Anthropology is subjective. So these have to be scaled. They have to be brought on a parity. So when they do that process, some optionals are somehow not giving good scores. So check whether the optional you want to choose is performing well in UPSC or not. That's a very important parameter. The optional that you are choosing must be performing well in UPSC in addition to these parameters. How does anthropology fare on all these parameters? Let us now see. I gave you the parameters, right? What makes a good optional? Does anthropology fit? First, if you are in Hyderabad, what is the best thing? You are in the anthropology capital of the country, because most anthropology, the best anthropology coaching is found in Hyderabad. For other subjects like sociology or even geography, political science, maybe you will get better support system in Delhi perhaps. But when it comes to anthropology, even those who are preparing from Delhi come to Hyderabad. Because the way optionals evolved, anthropology has always been a Hyderabad-based optional. That's why most students who write with anthropology are from Hyderabad. Most teaching, most material is from Hyderabad. In Delhi, you will not find such good quality teaching for anthro. So, location-wise, if you are in Hyderabad, anthropology makes sense because you are in the place of the country where it is taught really well. So in Hyderabad, you have best teachers, you have a lot of material, and more importantly, you have many friends who are taking same optional. So you'll get to discuss, do combined studies, share notes, share materials, share ideas, show each other's answers. So all this will come to your benefit. Next, what are the unique benefits of anthropology? First, it's a very simple subject. If you go through syllabus, you're not studying something like calculus or quantum mechanics, right? You're going to study simple things like family, marriage, kinship, religion. Things which you're already aware of. You're not studying things that are totally out of the box. So, things that you are already familiar with, we are going to study them in a more scientific manner. That's the only difference. The subject, the syllabus is simple, familiar, questions are repetitive. In Anthro, why are many choosing Anthro, especially in Hyderabad? Papers are relatively straightforward. In GS, you anyway don't expect to get questions that you know. You go there, see the paper and see what do I know about this. But with anthropology, questions are largely predictable and questions often repeat from previous years. So if you have prepared previous year questions, then it becomes easy to attempt the paper. So the syllabus is simple, papers are easy, and there is so much teaching and material available. That is why many students don't know this when they are beginning, like at your stage. So they choose some optional. Then after 3 attempts, they realize they have chosen the wrong optional. Then they want to shift. But if you had the right guidance in the beginning stage itself, you would have saved those 3 attempts, right? So in anthropology, I come across many students who have gone to the interview stage and then want to come to anthropology from geography, from public administration and so on. In fact, there's a famous example of a topper, Anudeep. He got rank in 5th attempt. For first 4 attempts, he wrote with public administration. In 5th attempt, he changed to anthropology. Now, a fresher may not be aware, right? But somebody like him, who is already in IRS, and who has written with PubEd for 4 years, he knows which optional works and which doesn't work, right? He doesn't need somebody to tell him what is right. He knows by experience. So if he is choosing anthropology at 5th attempt, what does that tell you? That this optional is doing really good in the exam. So much so that he took the risk of changing his optional midway after giving 4 attempts. So that is a very live example of whether anthropology is a good optional or not. So in the last few years, what we have seen is students with Anthro are doing really well, and because the paper is easy, since you can study your Anthro really well in a short time, you can now give channel more effort to GS. The time you save in optional can be rationed out to GS. Whereas somebody is struggling with optional to finish syllabus, they don't have the same time to handle GS. They're going to lag behind. So that is why Anthro is a good optional. Next, does it help with GS? What do you think? Does anthropology help with GS? Does anthropology help with GS? Yes. Where does anthropology help with GS? First of all, anthropology is also a social science. And if you see, this exam is largely an exam of social sciences. So, first, those students with Anthro will have relative ease with history and society. So, in GS1, you have topics like history and Indian society. Almost most students of anthropology don't prepare for Indian society. They just go and write right away in the examination. And when you understand Anthro well, your understanding of history becomes very easy. Because anthropology and history are also some kind of sister disciplines. So, our understanding of history becomes easy. And with Anthro, we study a lot of, especially in physical Anthro, we study a lot of biotech. So, once again, in your S&T paper, a lot of issues in S&T paper become very simple to you. In addition, we will discuss many provisions of constitution and their applicability to weaker sections like Dalits, like tribals, like minorities. Because of this, in GS2 polity paper, when you study various government schemes and when you study the working of the constitution for the weaker sections, you will again feel a lot of ease in handling those topics. And finally, in topics like ethics, in ethics, you have to answer case studies, right? So, when you have a subject like Anthro, students are able to respond to case studies with a multi-dimensional perspective. They are able to highlight the issues of culture, of weaker sections, of society. Because of that, their answers to case studies stand out compared to those with geography or PubMed or with maths or other optionals. So, having Anthro gives you benefit across papers. That is the importance of Anthro. That's why I think with Anthro, you also have quite a benefit when it comes to handling your general studies. Next, why here in Law Excellence? What is unique about anthropology here? Yes? How does my teaching feel like? In fact, the workshop should convey a sense to you. I don't believe in a passive teaching. What is passive teaching? Passive teaching is, I speak, you all listen. Yes? Elaborate. Yes, what do we do in passive teaching? I teach, you all listen. And when you are listening, your mind wanders away. Somewhere you will come back and you will catch some words, and that is all that stays in your mind. The rest is all like a wind, it has gone past you without really sticking to you. That is why I do not believe in passive teaching. I believe in active teaching. What is active teaching?
Interaction.
So my classes will be highly interactive. I pose questions. I make students first respond through questions, and we will have a dialogue. Then I will also explain. So it won't just be a monologue. You have to participate in the class. It will be highly interactive. And I also believe in blended learning. What is blended learning? Yes? Blended learning means not just using lecture. For example, we tried a video today. Now, if I had talked about chinchus for 1 hour, would you have understood so much? You would have tried to imagine how do chinchus look. But those 20 minutes conveyed more to you than I would convey in a 2 hour lecture, right? So, I believe in the power of video, the power of visual medium. Why does a movie stick to your mind but a class doesn't stick to your mind? You watch a movie 2 years ago, it will still stay in your memory. But a class that you had listened in the morning will not stick to your memory. Why? Visual effect. So, we will use various such tools to make you feel a participant in the class. So, we will have discussions, questions, interactive sessions, and we will also use videos. We will use discussions. I will make students come and present here. So, compared to listening to me, if you listen to one of your peers, your friends, would it have a different impact on you? So, that is how we try to make learning interesting. If you sit in a class passively and just listen to me, it will not stick to you. But if you participate, if you have visual form of learning, if you have some presentations, all of these multiple methods will enrich your learning process. That is how I structure my course. That is how the teaching is going to be. And on top of this, I give a lot of handouts where I also use schematics, diagrams. A picture speaks 1,000 words. So we will try to take a lot of pictures, and for your reading material, I choose the best books, many books from various American universities and top Indian universities, the latest research. So we take those books and give to you. I don't give outdated content. You're all in 21st century, whereas many are still reading books of 1980s. So many books that you are given outside are highly outdated in their content. With such a book, with such reading materials, you are at a disadvantage. Imagine trying to use a Nokia phone when everybody else around you is using a smartphone. There is a clear difference of your work efficiency, right? Same goes with reading material too. We must be using the latest material. So here, I give my students the best and latest material taken from the best of universities. Since you don't have the time to read through all those big books, it is my job to take the relevant portions, simplify it and give it to you. And along with this, in each class, we will also take previous questions, discuss answers, and discussion of previous year questions and answer writing will be a undercurrent throughout the course. This is how we try to make optional very student friendly and very much accessible to the student, right? Is this clear? What is unique about my teaching to anthropology? It is not going to be based on traditional passive methods and it is not going to be based on outdated content. We will be more active and we will be more latest and updated in our approach. Lastly, how is the course structured? The last basic question. This is the basic question that many students have, right? How is the course structured? So we will follow a 16-week approach. This is a micro schedule that is part of your handout too. In the handout, I gave the micro schedule, I gave a book list, I gave some answers that we will be discussing, some model answers which we will be discussing. Please spend time with this handout after the class and go through this. So we plan a 16-week program for anthropology, depending on if students are, some batch students are very participative, so they speak more than I do. Then the batch gets extended by a week or so, because we have a lot of discussion and participation. But ideally, we have a 16-week program with 1-2 weeks of adjustment in the curriculum. So we finish the course in 16 weeks, so broadly 4 months. And classes will be from 2 to 4, like the workshop, 2 hours every day, Monday to Friday. And we may take an extra class on Saturday whenever we have the need. So this is the program and you will get handouts. I will dictate notes in the class. You will also get reading material along with sectional tests and also full length tests at the end of the course with direct feedback from me. And I think the course is available both in online, offline as well as recorded format. You can come to the class, offline is ideal, or you can watch live online classes. On top of this, we are also giving recorded classes for students. You can watch the recorded class maybe one day after the class has been finished, right? So these are the basic details about the course. That concludes my presentation. And now if you have any questions, we can address those questions before we conclude the session. Yes, any questions please? I gave you book list. Please go through the list of books. Please go through the list of books and also the various parts of the handout. And do you have any other questions that you would like me to take before we can conclude? The course starts from Monday, August 30th. August 30th, Monday is when we are beginning our course, and from then it will take us 4 months. September, October, November and December. By December end, we will be able to wind up our course, right? So that is the broad framework I have in mind. Yes, those who are online through Zoom, please feel free to raise your questions through Zoom chat. I'll be very glad to answer your queries.
Sir, what should be the highest course?
One minute. Yes. Highest score of my? One student got about 320 last year. What do you think? Yes? Yes? Yeah, very good. That's a very common question I get from students. Let us see what questions are here before we take that. Yes, first, let me take that question. It's a common question that we get from many students, that is it heavy on biology? First, there is some misconception that especially physical anthropology has a lot to do with biology. Is it true? Not really. If it is a lot of biology, why would you have it in anthropology? So, we have to understand some trends in human evolution. To that extent, you have to know some high school biology, 10th class biology, like what is human skeleton like? What is cell division? Like what is cell division? What is cell structure? And what is human skeleton like? Some basic high school biology background is needed to understand, that's all. And this high school biology background will be covered to you in your S&T classes. And in anthropology, wherever we are, I feel that you need a background. I will do backgrounder sessions before going into the concept so that you don't feel any barrier. You should not feel a sense of discomfort in understanding those issues. So, first of all, that is just relevant to some portions of physical anthropology, and even there we will first do a backgrounder and then get into the concept. And where there is an issue, I will give a separate handout on with diagrams for, let's say, human body, diagrams for cell, and with a chart showing and defining the various terms of the various terms that are new to you. Only after you have become familiar with those basic terms, we will continue. And we will have a Telegram group where I will post a lot of supportive content which you can watch after the class to brush up those basics. So do not have that fear, because you have many toppers from anthropology who are not from biology background. They are rankers. There is a famous officer here in Telangana. She is in the CMO, Smita Sabarwal. She got 4th rank with anthropology. She is from BA, arts background. Then there are some from engineering, BTech background. The collector of Siddipet, Muzamil Khan, is from BTech. He got rank with anthropology. He is from computer science. Then there are many rankers with doctors who are from anthropology, like Bharat Gupta, the collector of Chittur. So what you see is, students from multiple disciplines, medicine, biology background, engineering background, arts background, are all able to do well with anthropology. That is because anthropology has a unique mix of arts and science. Physical anthropology is science, like science. Sociocultural anthropology is like arts. So it has a healthy mix of both these disciplines. That is what makes it easy. Yes. Yes. Yes, G. Singh is asking for syllabus of book list for subject. Yes, all this, the handout will be posted right away on Zoom. Narasimha, please post the handout on the Zoom window itself, so the students have access to it. So don't worry. Our team will post a direct soft copy to you on Zoom chat itself. You can download the soft copy from Zoom chat. Next, Sita. Everybody is writing same answers. How it is different from other options? How what is average mark? Average mark is something like 250 to 60. High score is anything above 290 and 300. High score is anything above 290 and 300 is a high score. How do you differentiate yourself from everybody else? First, by writing latest ideas. Many students of anthro write ideas of 80s and 90s. The first way to differentiate yourself in the competition is write the latest ideas. Then use diagrams, use examples, use thinkers wherever needed. Through these four methods, latest ideas, diagrams, case studies and examples, thinkers, and using current affairs. Through this five-pronged strategy, you can stand out, make your answer stand out from everybody else in the competitive pool. That is how we will stand out. Clear? You stand out by these methods. If you write a plain answer, it will be one among the many in the crowd. You will get average marks, like Sita is asking us. So how do you differentiate yourself? By these five methods: latest ideas, diagrams, examples, case studies, latest data, and current affairs. This is how you try to make yourself unique from everybody else in the competition. Right? Next. Any other question, please? I will discuss. You don't have to buy all these books. As we begin the course, when we begin, I divide the course into modules. At each module, I will tell you which books to buy. You can begin with Ember and Ember. Anthropology by Ember and Ember, first book. Yes? For each topic, for each, like, we discuss three disciplines, right? For each discipline of the three chapters, keep one book as reference. Just stick to that. But you may not even need that. Our class notes, handouts, and materials will do first level of reading. Then as you revise after the course, as you keep revising again and again, then you may refer the books for more diagrams, examples, or any other thing that we may miss. So the books are meant to be as a reference to go in case you have any doubt. And you also need to read some textbooks to develop a feel for subject. Tomorrow if you go to interview and they ask you, what books have you read? You should not say, I have read La Excellence material. You should be able to say, I have read Anthropology by Ember and Ember. So that is why I also make my students read the books, so that they are able to connect with the subject directly. Otherwise, you are always dependent on me. If the moment the course is done, you will be left confused. But if you develop a relationship with the subjects and the books, even with or without me, you will feel empowered. So we believe in empowering the student. We don't believe in making the student a dependent. When the student feels empowered by the end of the course, he or she will learn on their own. So that is another unique aspect of my teaching. I don't believe that students have to be forced to learn. I believe that you are all natural learners. If you are not learning naturally, it is my fault. I am probably not teaching it to you well enough. So I believe that the role of a teacher is to stimulate curiosity in the student. Once I trigger curiosity in you, you will learn automatically. Do I have to create curiosity about a movie in you? You are naturally curious, right? Does somebody have to tell you to go and watch a movie? You do it without anybody telling you. But why do you have difficulty with studying? Maybe because you have lacked curiosity. So through the course and through the classes, I will try to develop interest and curiosity in you, such that your inner natural instinct to learn should be triggered. That should be the objective of the course, isn't it? If I trigger that fire in you, with or without me, you will always learn. But if that fire is not triggered in you, what will happen? You will come to classes. The moment they are over, you forget about it. Anthropology will be like a science fiction movie. You watched, it felt relevant, but have not understood much. So my classes and my course will not be like that. So I believe in that philosophy. The philosophy that every student is a natural learner. And it is my duty, it is our duty to trigger that fire for learning, trigger that curiosity for learning in the student, and all my teaching will be oriented in that direction. Right? So that is all we have. So if you don't have any other questions, then we will close the session for today and we will meet on Monday, the 30th of August, to begin our lecture. Yes, any other queries that you would like me to address, please? Which paper is? We cannot make a generalization. See, both papers are different. Paper 1 is more broad of concepts and very relatively many concepts are present. So those, let's say, between essay and GS paper, which paper is easy? What do you find easy? You will find paper 1 to be easy. Some people find essay paper to be very easy. They cannot remember a lot of things, but they are good at the big picture. They are good at analyzing an issue. Then paper 2 will be easy. Paper 2 is about open-ended thinking. It is about taking an issue and analyzing it from a 360 degree point of view, like an essay. You have to write a lot, elaborately, and explain. Any paper 2 is like that, any optional. Paper 1 is like GS paper, full of concepts, thinkers, definitions, terms, ideas to remember and learn and write. So, if somebody is good at remembering things, making good notes, revising it regularly, paper 1 is very easy for them. But for somebody else, analyzing, if somebody else has interest in reading a lot of open-ended things and trying to understand an issue in depth, for them, paper 2 will be easy. By and large, many students tend to like paper 2 because they tend to like tribes. Paper 2 has Indian tribes. So many students fall in love with the tribal people. You watch Chenchus, right? What do you think of them? They are innocent. Yes, what else can you think of them? Many would think they are backward. But are they really backward? Or let me ask you a different question. Is there anything we can learn from them? Is there anything that we can learn from Chenchus? Yes? Unity or collective spirit? Then? If you are asked, of course, if I ask the other question, what can they learn from you? I'm sure you'll give me a list, long list. But if I ask you, what can you learn from them? What can you learn from them? Yes? Very good. Are they living in harmony with nature? Or are they exploiting nature like we do?
No.
They are polluting nature. Yes, are they?
No.
They are living in harmony with nature, right? So much so, they don't go for hunting when animals are breeding. There is a breeding season when animals are in reproductive phase. In that phase, they have a ban on hunting. They don't catch young animals. They only go after adult, fully grown animals. So they are very sensitive to their nature. Yes, what else? What else can you learn from them? Anything else in terms of attitude to life? In terms of attitude to life, can you learn anything from them? Yes? Contentment? They are not going off chasing things like, I have to buy a BMW, I have to buy an iPhone, I have to go to a European trip, I must live in a penthouse. Do they have such dreams?
No.
Very content. Are they celebrating life? Lot of song, dance, music. They are living in the present, right? How do we all live?
Past or future.
Past or future, right? You are always worrying about what has happened in the past, or you are planning about future and living in the fear of future. What will happen next? Do you pay attention to present? Does future come to you as future or present? Future comes to you as present, but you are always trying to live in future. So when it comes to you as present, ultimately you do not know how to deal with it because you only know how to think of future. Chenchus have the problem. They are living in the moment, right? Celebrating the life as it is. So this is how, that is the lesson from Chenchus. We will see that there are many such lessons we can learn as a modern civilization from them. Of course, they can take away a lot from us. They can access modern technology from us. They can gain access to modern healthcare, vaccines, medicine, cures. They can get access to pure drinking water perhaps, better, cleaner living conditions. All this can be gotten from us. They can gain from us. And we can take many things from them too. So that is how we will discuss, that is how we can, many students fall in love with tribes. That is why they do well in paper 2. To answer your question, many students generally tend to like paper 2 because paper 2 is very lively. Caste system, villages, tribal people, their problems. Many feel touched by tribal people problems. So much so, I have had students who went and did field trips to tribal areas, to Bhadrachalam area, to Rampa Chodavaram, to Araku, just to feel and see how these people live. They are just amazed by the simplicity of these people, the innocence, as Pratyusha has pointed it out to us. So that is why many students tend to fall in love with the tribal people and their way of life. That makes paper 2 very scoring and interesting, right? I'll make sure the handout has been uploaded, Alam, or it will be sent to you in Telegram, don't worry. Our team, they must be engaged in other activity. I'll just make sure they upload it on Zoom itself. Musunuri Sainath, I missed this session. Yes, this entire session is being recorded and it will be put on YouTube. So don't worry, you can access the recorded version of this workshop on YouTube. In case you have missed this live, or if you want to watch it again, it will be available on YouTube. Any other question, please? That's it. How many? I have been teaching this for about 6 years now. And when I was writing, I scored some of the high scores in anthropology. I attended 3 interviews and I am a graduate from IIT Madras. So, an engineer turned, a person who gave up engineering and fell in love with the social sciences. So, I have studied anthropology, history, sociology, political science, many optionals in great detail. So, when I teach anthropology, it will not come from just the narrow base of anthro. My classes are very different and interesting because we approach anthropology from multi-dimensional viewpoint. I don't rely just on anthro. We borrow many concepts from other areas to make our anthropology very lively. Next, requirement of current affairs. So that is another question, very good question that I forgot to address. So among the optionals, current affairs is an important event. Among all the optionals, sociology has the highest amount of current affairs. So students of sociology are struggling because, one, they have to study the syllabus. On top of it, they have to always cover the huge current affairs. After sociology, political science has the next highest current affair burden. Anthropology has very little role for current affairs. We have very limited role for current affairs. And whatever current affairs are in the news, at the end of every year, I will compile a current affair module and give it to you, so that you don't have to do the job yourself. First of all, as it is, the role of current affairs is very less. It is very less compared to many other optionals. So you don't have that fear and worry, because in GS you already have enough to handle. With optional, it is not so much. Right? All right then, we will close our session here and we will begin our course starting with 30th of this month, that is the Monday. Right? All right, pleasure discussing with you, being with you here, and I look forward to seeing all of you in my class on next Monday. Yes. Oh, Harsha. I am Harsha Manav. I hope you already knew my name. So I didn't bother to discuss that formality. Most of my students come with a well-researched detail, so I won't waste my time getting into the trivia. Right? All right then. We'll wind up our session here and we will continue on Monday.